Simon & Schuster Audio presents Spoiler Alert: The Hero Dies by Michael Ausiello. Read by the author.
To Kit, Olive Juice, Always and Forever. Previously on. Our relationship was over before it began. Less than 15 minutes into our first date, I discovered that the tall drink of water sitting across from me by the name of Kit Cowan watched zero television, although he admitted to rewatching, over and over again, old episodes of Ab Fab on his VCR. This explained the glazed-over look in his eyes when I mentioned that my favorite current series was Felicity, starring my soulmate, kindred spirit, Kerry Russell. "Oh wait, is she the one whose haircut almost got the show canceled?" he exclaimed way too proudly, as if bragging. "See, I know stuff." "Yes," I sighed with an exaggerated eye roll that properly conveyed my half-serious contempt that he just reduced Queen Kerry to a trivial pursuit question. "I'm actually going to be on Felicity," I boasted. "I'm going to make a cameo in the episode where she graduates as part of a story I'm writing for TV Guide. I'm flying out to LA in January to shoot it." "Oh, so you're a bit of a celebrity," he asked rhetorically. "Hardly a celebrity," I clarified before deadpanning. "But generally speaking, I'm a pretty big deal. You should be aware of that." Kit let out a fairly noisy cackle as the waitress at Corallo Trattoria, a well-reviewed Italian restaurant in New York's Soho district, dropped off the wine list. "Should we order a bottle?" Kit inquired. "Actually, I'm not much of a wine drinker," I replied. "Ever?" he asked. "Pretty much," I said. "I don't particularly enjoy the taste. Same goes for beer." I could see him processing this new information as he unfurled his napkin and rested it on his lap with a poised precision that suggested to me that he had grown up around money. "We could do cocktails instead," he replied. "I think I'm just going to have a Diet Coke," I declared with an opposing mix of embarrassment and, "sorry, but this is how I roll" swagger. "Diet Coke," he responded, bemused by this sudden twist. "Yeah, I'm not a big alcohol drinker." "You're not an alcoholic, are you?" he asked with a raised eyebrow. "Nope, I've just never been a big drinker," I asserted, without divulging that what I really disliked about alcohol was the empty calories and the loss of control. "I do, however, love the taste of Diet Coke," I added, "especially when it comes from a fountain versus a bottle or a can." "Oh, so you're a Diet Coke connoisseur," he said mockingly. "If you must slap a label on me, sure," I shot back. "But it's actually more of a Diet Cola connoisseur, since I'm also open to a nice Diet Pepsi." "Oh, this is good to know," he said, adopting a faux serious tone, before pulling out of his pocket a small notepad which was affixed to an even smaller pencil. He flipped through to what I assumed was a clean page and proceeded to dictate a message to himself. "He is a connoisseur of Diet Coke and Diet Pepsi," he said slowly and with an air of satirical judgment. He then closed the book, tucked it back into his pocket, and half smiled at me as he took a swig of water. Holy fucking shit. He was keeping a running list of my eccentricities? Or was it a red flag tally? In either case, it was a little unsettling, but mostly it was goddamn hilarious. He was hot and could flawlessly land a comedic bit without breaking a sweat. Things were looking up. "You should probably keep that pad out," I informed him, cryptically and sassily. "That list is going to get a lot longer tonight." I then punctuated my retort with my own carefully timed sip of water, as if to say, "Game on, playa." That saucy interplay set the tone for what ended up being an enormously entertaining, enlightening, flirtatious, and fun dinner, during which I learned that he had not, as I assumed, been born with a silver spoon in his mouth. As Kit, whose birth name is Christopher, explained, he had grown up the only child of a toolmaker dad and a quilt-making mom in a small podunk town in Pennsylvania called Millersburg, not to be confused with Millersville, he clarified, whose biggest claim to fame was that it didn't have a single traffic light within its 1 square mile border. Everyone knew everyone's business, he sighed. Not an ideal environment to grow up secretly gay. After high school, he attended the local Harrisburg Area Community College, where he majored in photography before completing his four-year education at the Rochester Institute of Technology, RIT, graduating with a Bachelor of Fine Arts degree in Photographic Arts and Sciences. He had then continued his education at the University of Miami, where, with the help of a full scholarship, he had earned his master's in art and art history. I decided not to ruin a perfectly fine evening by telling him that what I knew about photography and art could fit on the head of a pin. Kit had lived and worked in Miami after graduation before deciding to make the move to New York with nothing but himself and a huge U-Haul filled with select vintage furniture and photography equipment. A friend of a friend had connected him with a woman whose behaviorally challenged son, Kirby, was looking for a roommate to share a spacious, rent-controlled three-bedroom apartment on the Upper West Side. In exchange for dealing with her son's myriad idiosyncrasies, Kit only had to pay an unheard of $400 a month for his very own bedroom and bathroom and use of the unit's common areas, if he should so please. It was a sweet deal, he noted, although not one without its drawbacks. Kit warned me that in addition to being untidy, Kirby didn't deal well with people who were different from him, which was why he never explicitly looped him in on his sexual orientation. Despite Kit's discretion, I got the sense that the relationship was not a healthy one. Kit was also not out to his parents, which was odd and slightly concerning given that he was 28 years old and it was 2001. Almost immediately after arriving in New York a year ago, he had landed a job as assistant creative director for the fast casual restaurant chain Cozy, where he oversaw the design and implementation of all the franchise's visuals, from menu boards to napkins to store signage. "I love my job," he shared, "but the atmosphere can be a little intense. I'm constantly reminding my coworkers, at the end of the day, we're just selling sandwiches, people." He also confessed to being a major computer nerd and an acolyte of Steve Jobs. "Oh wait, is he the guy with the apples?" I sassed, before sarcastically explaining to him that we in the business refer to that as a callback. Cut to Kit's similarly exaggerated, extremely playful eye roll. Oh yes, ladies and gents, I was on fire. I presented Kit with the Cliff Notes rundown of my life story, offering snapshots of my small-town New Jersey upbringing, although apparently not as small as his, my escape to the West Coast to attend college at the University of Southern California, USC, my obsession with and subsequent career in television, which led to my gig at TV Guide. I also divulged to him that I had lost both of my parents by the age of 22, my mom to cancer, my dad to heart disease, to which he expressed genuine sympathy but not, and this was important, pity. Our boyfriend history was fairly similar. We had both had one major prior relationship of similar duration, 3 years, and end date, less than 2 years ago. Our girlfriend history, however, diverged greatly, in that I'd never had one and he, well, had. And a serious adult one at that. All told, what we lacked in common interest, we more than made up for in snark-filled chemistry. I wrapped up dinner wanting to know more about him. I got the distinct impression he felt the same about me. We split the bill, proceeded outside, and faced that awkward, "what do we do now?" quandary. It was clear that neither of us wanted the evening to end. "We could go back to my place and hang out," Kit suggested sheepishly. "I don't know," I hedged. "We don't have to have sex," he assured me. "We could just hang out." I'm not sure I'd be able to restrain myself. And with that, Kit pulled out his notebook and pretended to write, "No willpower." I stood there silently and smiled, giving his perfectly timed callback room to breathe. I wanted so badly to make out with him right there on the street. I resisted on account of not wanting to get gay bashed. Yes, it was 2001. It was also, you know, 2001. But it was an exercise in extreme self-control. It had been 48 hours since Kit and I first laid eyes on each other at New York's Webster Hall, the site of the Gay Sports Ball, an annual event that was a mashup of my favorite things, gay athletes and gay music and, if I was lucky, gay tonsil hockey. My BFF and wingman Matt Erickson was my plus one, and it would be our first social outing since the events of 9/11 exactly 2 months earlier. Like most New Yorkers, I became something of a hermit in the weeks following 9/11. I would head straight home to my one-bedroom apartment in Bloomfield, New Jersey, after putting in a full day at TV Guide's Midtown Manhattan offices, and lose myself in fresh episodes of my then-obsessions Friends, Felicity, Gilmore Girls, 24, and such. The idea of going to a bar to continue my elusive pursuit of a cute boyfriend amid fears of another terrorist attack, an approaching war, and anthrax-laced snail mail did not interest me, I also just wasn't in the mood for revelry of any kind. The world was falling apart, and I needed to focus my full-time attention on whether Felicity was going to choose Ben or Noel. If anything can snap me out of my 9/11 funk, it's a gay athlete, I joked to Matt, who luckily was also ready to dip his toe back into New York City nightlife. And for what it's worth, I was an avid runner, which technically made me an athlete too. So I wasn't so much attending the gay sports ball 2001 to stalk hot guys as I was going there to kick it with my peeps. Yep, that was my story and I was sticking to it. Within minutes of Matt and me making our first loop through Webster Hall, I spotted someone I knew, Nate. We were both members of the Gay Activist Alliance of Morris County, GAMIC, New Jersey's longest operating LGBT organization. We had become acquainted through the 20-something support group, but this was the first time I'd seen him out in the proverbial wild. He was with a small gaggle of friends, one of whom immediately caught my eye. This particular slice of heaven was tall, probably 6'2 or 6'3, slim build, aquiline nose, smart glasses, sexy in a nerdy kind of way, and I could tell by the way he was chomping on that little cocktail straw that he didn't lack confidence. Sign me up. A quick round of introductions yielded the hottie in question's name, Kit. I caught up with Nate all the while making googly eyes at Kit. Lucky for me, the googly eyes were being returned, and then some. Houston, we had a spark. And we had a problem. Nate and his entourage wanted to move onto the dance floor. Now, what happened next would be the subject of much heated debate over the course of our entire 13-and-a-half-year relationship. According to Kit, I immediately lunged toward him, desperately crying out, "No, don't go!" I, however, recall taking a more subtle approach, something along the lines of, "You sure you don't want to hang out here a little longer, you handsome, sexy fuck?" Regardless, Kit ended up staying behind with me, while Nate and his crew, which now included Matt, moved on to gayer pastures. Maybe it was the residual high from my one-sided flirtation with the captain of the flag football team downstairs, but the moment Kit and I were alone, I boldly moved my lips toward his and yanked that cocktail straw right out of his mouth and into mine. "Excuse you," he mock reprimanded me as I smiled sheepishly at him. Without missing a beat, he charged at me and snatched that straw back. "Oh, I see how it's gonna be," I sassed. We would repeat this unusual mating ritual continuously over the next 9 minutes, our mouths never once touching. The pace of our straw play gradually sped up and ended in him kissing me. Holy shitballs, he looks like that and he's an A-plus kisser? I immediately charged back at him and stole a second kiss, and then a third, and then a fourth. By the 10th, we decided to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.